easier opponent.
No, not at all. I mean, first of all, even if you think he's an easier opponent, no matter what, when you switch up opponents, you got a different style. Mentally, that plays a part on in a fight. So, mentally, it's harder no matter what. You know, and I think that the UK fans were already happy. They didn't care who they was fighting you. You know, if Joshua was fighting you, he'd still be happy. No, they just want to see their boy fight. But us, yeah, we were a little bit upset. But now we look at Ruiz's track record. Hey, this guy could bang. This guy's fast.
I mean, obviously, you know, I remember the media workout we did with Canelo Alvarez back in December. There's just as many people in here. So obviously, the UK fans, they're not worried about his opponent. Right. They're here front center. And Canelo's been established in this country for a long time. Right. This is AJ's first fight, and this place here at Brookfield Plaza is packed.
Right. We're going to see the real boxing fans, the UK fans. And I think that we're kind of ready now as a people, as a boxing fan, to accept a UK champion as long as he fights here in the States.
No, absolutely. And you know what? The American boxing fans need to take notes here, man. The dedication and you know, of these UK fans.
He said that, not me.
Listen, I love you guys, but these guys are flying in by the droves and thousands to watch AJ fight, and they don't care who his opponent is. But I want to talk about his opponent really quick.
Okay.
Andy Ruiz, fast hands, moves around a lot more than Gerald Miller, so this fight might be more difficult. AJ not only had to make adjustments, but what about the pressure of fighting at MSG, the mecca of boxing?
That's something that Floyd used to always say. Floyd said, yeah, you've been a champion for years, but you never fought on my level, no matter who it is that he fought. And I think that sometimes that could play, you know, a mental factor in a game where, yeah, you've been fighting for years and you might not be nervous, but when you have 20,000 people in the crowd, everybody's rooting against you, that's kind of tough.
Yeah, and look, let's not compare it to the 80,000 that watch him in the UK. This is different. This is a historic arena.
Right,
you know,
right.
So there's going to be added pressure to that. Obviously, Deontay Wilder having a first-round knockout against Dominic Brazil, that has to be in the back of his mind.
Right.
I got to get this guy out of there quick. So, yeah, a lot of variables in Joshua's head right now that are playing a part, but I think he's going to rise to the occasion and shine under the bright lights in MSG.
Listen, when your name gets on that list with Muhammad Ali, Sugar Ray Robinson, our guy Sugar Ray Leonard, of course that's pressure. That's crazy. I mean, your name is getting written in history in the mecca of boxing.
Listen, you talk about mecca, like, you know, since 1883, if I'm not mistaken,
you
know,
go throwing dates,
John
bro.
L. Sullivan, you know, who's the most notable, the first
you just
notable
thought about that,
heavyweight
huh?
champion. Yeah, just thought about that randomly. Fought twice at MSG. 1883.
Wow.
So you talk about history.
Wow.
Yeah, we all love Vegas. We all love the MGM and all that.
Right.
But there's no more historic arena than MSG. So Joshua knows that. He's a student of the game.
Right.
He wants to stamp his name, and I'm excited to see it.
And something about New York fans, too. They don't just root for you. You got to win them over. So,
right.
Yeah, Joshua's used to fighting in front of 90,000, maybe even almost 100,000 people. But if you can win our hearts, you're truly a champion.
You know what I think we need? A little, not shove. We don't want to emulate the Big Baby Miller press conference, but we need a little smack talking, at least by the way, which I'm looking forward to on Friday.
Maybe. But let's go back to Lauren and Sergio.
Thanks a lot, boys. Yeah, you made some great points there. So much history and tradition of boxing at MSG. And the guy who was able to orchestrate this entire event, Eddie Hearn, the president of Matchroom Boxing. Now, Eddie, first of all, thank you for joining us here for the Fighter Workout. So much going on here behind us. The crowd, already incredible. What are you excited about most for this event?
Well, it's an honor for us to be even promoting at Madison Square Garden. You know, I think any boxing fan, particularly any fighter, this is the absolute mecca of boxing. And I can't tell you how excited the fighters are to be getting that opportunity to box there. For us, we're looking forward to a really stacked card. You know, we're going to have a 19,000 sellout next week. We've got 8,000 Brits coming. They're going to be drinking a lot. They're going to be singing a lot. They're going to be making a lot of noise. And we wanted to put on a great card for them people. You know, obviously we've got Joshua against Ruiz. Joshua is, you know, an icon of the sport now, particularly in the UK. But so many other important fights on the card. Katie Taylor, the Queen of Ireland, going for the undisputed championship. Callum Smith, the best super middleweight in the world, defending his title against Hassan Ndam, former world champion. Tommy Coyle against Chris Algieri is just going to be an absolute war. Joshua Boatse against Periban, and Josh Kelly against Ray Robinson, which is a great fight, and sprinkled in with Ammo Williams and Diego Pacheco. So, you know, from 4:30 Eastern time right the way through till midnight, it's going to be an epic night of boxing.
Now, Eddie, it looks like you brought the British weather across the pond. What's going on here? This is rubbish.
We were supposed to be outside today, you know, but it's a great turnout in here. and Joshua's going to be in the ring in probably half an hour, and everyone will be coming to see him. It's been amazing. You know, yesterday was a great day. We had a welcome event for the media. Tomorrow is the undercard press conference. Thursday is the press conference. Friday is the weigh-in. You know, get yourself down there, 3 o'clock, MSG, free entry. Going to have a big turnout there as well. Got a lot of Brits coming straight from the airport. So we wanted to make sure this fight week builds into a crescendo before we get to MSG on Saturday night. In my opinion, you are about to see the best heavyweight on the planet make his American debut. And not just an American debut, but an American debut at Madison Square Garden. Sold out. There are other heavyweights in the world right now from America who can't fill half an arena, and they're fighting in their own country. So this guy is an iconic figure in the sport, but he's got a win. And you know, we saw Deontay Wilder put in a brilliant performance a couple of weeks ago, and now it's like, over to you, AJ. You know, so there is that pressure to look good with all the pullouts, the Miller situation. I just want him to win. You know, and we know Ruiz, you know about Ruiz. People in boxing know about Ruiz. And despite the fact of not looking like Joshua and his shorts, we know he's got fast hands. We know he's got a good boxing IQ. We know he's got a good engine. We know he's got good movement. He's got all the things that actually trouble Joshua. You know, you look at the Takam fight, you look at the Povetkin fight, they were smaller guys who move well. And I think he's going to come out and really let his hands go. And that's one of the reasons that I picked him. I could have picked a guy who might have froze on the night and gone one round and got knocked out. Andy Ruiz will go for this. He's got a chance to become the first ever Mexican world heavyweight champion. He's fighting for legacy, history. He's fighting for a lot of money. And he's fighting for a chance to just blow up the world heavyweight scene.
A tremendous opportunity for Andy Ruiz Jr. Now, take us back to that day when you found out that Jarrell Miller was not able to fight. What was going through your head, and what was the first action that you took? I can't even imagine what that was like.
As a boxing promoter, you're kind of waiting for bad news. You know, like, just, but that's like the worst kind of news. So I remember it so clearly. I was actually at home. I just got home from work. I've got two daughters, and I think I was in the lounge watching them do gymnastics. And my colleague phoned me, and he just said, just to let you know, Jarrell Miller's failed a drugs test. And I'm like, and it was one of those moments, it was like a cop on call. I just said to my wife and kids, I've got to go, right? I went into a room, a spare room in my house. I laid down on the bed, and I like sort of went into some kind of meditation state. I was like, okay, stay calm. What are you going to do right now? Think. And it was just going through the motions of dealing with the commission, the governing bodies, and then speaking to Anthony. You know, I phoned him, he just finished sparring. I'm like, mate, I'm sorry. Miller's, he wasn't even that surprised. He was like, okay.
Really?
He just said, oh. Because I think, you know, I don't know whether he felt that Miller really had the cojones, if you like, to take him on. And he didn't even sound that surprised. So he was like, who are we going to fight? I said, who do you want to fight? He went, anyone. He went, get me Luis Ortiz. He's the guy. He's the next guy, really, that outside of Wilder and Fury. We made two offers to them for like, five times the money that he's ever earned in any particular fight. He turned it down. It went on for about a week. You know, we were talking to Michael Hunter, we were talking to Pulev, we were talking to Manuel Char, Trevor Bryan, Andy Ruiz. And Andy Ruiz reached out to me. He direct messaged me on Instagram. And he just said, I'm fighting on Saturday. He had a fight against on Fox, against Dimitrenko. He said, please give me this opportunity. I know I can beat Joshua. I will come to fight. And I was like, and it was only really his physique that kind of puts you off. Because if this guy was carved out of stone, Mexico would go crazy for this heavyweight. Like, when else has there been a world-class heavyweight from Mexico? And he is a world-class heavyweight. So I was like, oh, I don't know, there's Trevor Bryan, Manuel Char that look great on the scales, but they're not like, there's a mismatch. So I had to go with my heart. I had to go with a guy who believed he could win, who would bring the fire, and that's Andy Ruiz. And I'm so pleased I made that decision, because the more I've got to know him, you can't not like him. I mean, even Joshua's like, I like this guy, he's cool.
No, he's been self-promoting. Not only that, but he says all the right things. Yeah. And his last opponent in Alexander Dimitrenko, same size.
It's a carbon copy for AJ. I was talking to AJ about this morning, and I was like, he said to me, you know, Ruiz looks lighter. I said, yeah, I think he's lighter. I said, because he's super fit. He just did a camp. He fought, 3 weeks ago, four weeks ago, came out of that fight and went straight back into camp. And AJ's like, oh, yeah. So this ain't really a late replacement, is it? And I'm saying, and by the way, fought a guy who was perfect preparation for you, Dimitrenko. So it's like, hang on, this is not looking good.
This is the fastest return on a heavyweight. It's like 40-some-odd days to come back to fight. I mean, that's really impressive for him to stay active and come back to fight a guy that's similar to the last opponent you just fought. So that's dangerous.
Yeah, for sure. And I think where Andy's let himself in the down in the past is that inactivity and not taking himself too seriously away from... away from the sport. Now he's got that momentum where he's just had a fight, he's fit, he's ready, he's buzzing. I mean, when I look at his Instagram story, every day he's bought something new. You know, it was a diamond watch the other day, then I saw a car, you know, so he's spending his money before he's even got it.
That's incredible. Good for him.
He's going to be, you know, like, when I win this, like what I'm going to do is, you know, he really...
Win.
A lot of people don't rate Joshua, like fighters, until they get in there with him. You know, oh, he's robotic, oh, he does this. They don't see the footwork, they don't see the defense, the improvements, the jab, you know. He's improving. He's had 22 fights. And I think what he doesn't get enough credit for is his resume. Look at Deontay Wilder or Tyson Fury after 22 fights. Joshua has beaten Dillian White, Joseph Parker, Takam, Povetkin, Klitschko. Right, he's had 22 fights. He's still learning, but only now am I starting to see him actually develop as a fighter into not the finished article, but a really well-molded fighter. Because he only had 40 amateur fights, Sergio, as well. You know, Ruiz was a very good amateur.
Over 100 fights.
Exactly, the Mexican team. So Joshua is under extreme pressure always, while still having to learn on the job. And that was the amazing thing about the Klitschko fight. He'd had 17 fights going into the Klitschko fight. He was a complete novice. And he got knocked down, he had to come through, weather a storm, and he come back. But those kind of moments put you in great stead for what he's about to experience. This event is not just about the threat of Andy Ruiz, it's the threat of the new territory. You know, the new arena, different ring, different commission, different time zone, different pressures. So, coupled it all in, I'm nervous, because we've just got to win. And that's why people keep saying to me, do you think he needs to make a statement? I'm like, no, it just needs
to
win.
And it's just not any arena, it's Madison Square
Garden,
the iconic arena.
And that's why I wanted to put all these great fights on the card as well, because sometimes you only get one shot a night like this. And that's why I chose Ruiz, because I didn't want to sit there ringside with no fear or no excitement, just going, oh, let's hope this isn't embarrassing. Joshua's going to knock him out in a round. I want to be scared. And that's when we talk about the Wilder fight. People say, oh, Eddie Hearn don't want the Wilder fight. You're so wrong. I want to gamble. I want to be petrified. I want to walk out there with the hairs on my arms standing up, my heart beating through my chest. That's called excitement. That's sport. That's why everybody starts playing sport. That's why everybody loves watching sport. It's for those moments, not for an event that you know the answer to. So I'm scared because I know Ruiz is fearless. I don't even think he's digested how big this is for his life. He's just saying, I'm going to go in there and have fun. I'm going to let my hands go and I'm not going to stop throwing leather. But you're also going to get hit by a truck in Anthony Joshua. You're going to have three or four rounds of a real firefight here, and then I believe Joshua will start to get the measure of him and knock him out. But I'm glad I'm nervous, because I want the fans to have a great night. You know, if they're in the arena or if they're watching live on DAZN, you've got to give value for money. And there's nothing like value for money for an opponent that's really coming to win. Because a lot of people say they're going to do this, and they don't mean it. They know deep down. Ruiz, he hasn't digested it yet. He just thinks he's going to win. He just thinks he's going to move his head, get on the inside, throw big hooks and knock Joshua out. So let's hope it don't happen.
You know what, Eddie, thank you so much for your time. You are one of a kind and the best. We appreciate you putting this entire event together, and I know everyone.
Thank you, DAZN. We look forward to a great night. Don't miss it this Saturday.
Your favorite fighter, Katie Taylor, is on the undercard.
Legend. She's, honestly, you've got to talk to her at a fight. I mean, I'm sure you've talked to her before. Never seen a more driven individual in life. You know, two things in her life, boxing and God.
Boxing and God, and we're going to get a closer look at that right now.
I feel like I was born to be a pioneer. When I did start boxing, there was no female boxing at all in the country. So when I first started boxing as a 10 or 11 year old, I boxed against all the guys for the first few years, and when I took the headgear off after each fight, there was always uproar because I was a girl getting in against these guys all the time. My first official fight was when I was 15 years of age. It was a history-making fight. It was the first female boxing match in the country, in Ireland, and I had a big part of playing women's boxing into the Olympic Games as well. So I definitely really feel like I am a pioneer in the sport, which is a great legacy to leave behind as well. Female boxing wasn't even allowed in the country at the time. Now, looking back where I was there and where I am now and where women's boxing is right now in Ireland is packed with female boxers, and they don't have to go through the same battles and struggles that I had to go through when I first started. And that, to me, is the biggest victory ever. I think that's probably the most satisfying part about this whole journey.
Taylor goes to work here, Randy.
She's just very good. I mean, it's just that simple.
My social life is pretty much non-existent. I do probably pretty much live like a monk, but it works for me. I don't think I've been on a date in months and months. My dating life is pretty much non-existent as well. And God help the man that ever ends up with me.
Katie Taylor's breaking her back. Hard hook to the head.
Dominant, dominant, dominant.
Unification is every boxer's dream, I think. And to become the undisputed champion is the pinnacle of the sport. To be the undisputed champion, that's history-making right there. This is something I've dreamt of since I did turn pro. I want to become the undisputed champion, and here I am, a few weeks out from that. I have a chance to actually fulfill one of my dreams, which is absolutely incredible.
Katie Taylor going hooks to the body, and a right hand lands the combination.
Women's boxing is on a high right now. For the first time in the history of the sport, people are seeing the best of women's boxing, and that's why it's getting the reaction that it is right now. I think just the thoughts of becoming an undisputed champion. When I first started boxing as a 10 or 11 year old, I had a dream straight away that I wanted to become champion. Every person has a special plan in this life and a special purpose in this life, and I definitely feel like I was born to box.
Listen, if that doesn't inspire you, you probably don't have a pulse. The love for the sport, the passion, the discipline, all evident in that future right there. She will be defending her titles against Delphine Persone, who's standing by with Aachen Barak. Boys?
Let's watch Katie, who's a very popular fighter, obviously, and women's boxing is starting to become popular in itself. But they're saying you're her toughest test to date. Do you see yourself more than just a test?
Oh, yeah. We're going to see it on Saturday. Eh? We are prepared for this fight. We are looking 2 years for this fight, so we prepare as well. And I hope we're the best win the fight. Eh?
If you're able to win this fight, do you believe you're the best fighter in the world?
From the lightweight class, it's some different. There are different classes, and how heavier is another style of boxing. So we are the two best fighters, I think, for the moment of the lightweight class. And the winner of the fight is the best lightweight female boxer.
All right, well, listen, I'm excited to see this fight, so good luck on Saturday night. We're going to shoot over to David Diamante. Start this off.
From Brookfield Place, downtown New York City, ladies and gentlemen, the open workout continues. So Delphine Persone, the WBC champion, was just in here. And now, her opponent. This contest, 10 rounds of boxing scheduled for the unification of the WBA, WBC, IBF, and WBO championships of the world. This young woman is one of the biggest stars in boxing today. Her professional record, a perfect one. 13 fights, 13 victories, 6 of them coming by way of knockout. In 2012, she captured Olympic gold. And now, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the skilled and celebrated, reigning, defending, and undefeated WBA, IBF, and WBO lightweight champion of the world, fighting out of Bray, County Wicklow, Ireland, Katie Taylor!
Sergio, as we watch Katie Taylor here at the beginning of her fighter workout down in Lower Manhattan as we kick off fight week here. Anthony Joshua, Andy Ruiz Jr., what do you like about this fighter?
Everything. And I've been a big fan of Katie Taylor for a while, not only since she won Olympic gold, but she's been beating everyone they put in front of her. I mean, her last fight with Rose Valante was just exciting. Valante wasn't going anywhere, but she was able to stop her. That's been the only slight knock on Katie Taylor, the fact that she hasn't been stopping opponents, but she did that against Valante. I mean, Eva Volstrom, Cindy Serrano. I mean, the last weekend we saw McCaskill and Sanchez. They went at it, and possibly the women's fighter of the year. She beat both of them fighters. This is a superstar in front of us.
She is a superstar, and she is competing for the undisputed champion there in the lightweight division in women's boxing. What does this mean not only to women's boxing, but really just boxing in general?
No, boxing in general. The women are showing the men how to do it. I mean, they're not scared to unify, to become undisputed. Katie Taylor will be the third, only the third woman to become undisputed champion of the world alongside Cecilia Bracus and Clarissa Shields. So that's a big deal.
Yeah, it really is. At 43-1, you said there was one knock on her, and that's actually for Delphine Persoon. When you looked at her workout, I know we were talking to Eddie Hearn for a little bit, but what kind of a threat does she pose to Katie Taylor?
Well, she's a big, confident, she has a great one too. She fights good behind the jab. She has good pop, and she hasn't lost in almost 6 years, so that confidence is going to translate into the ring. She is a champion too, so you got to respect the fact that she's a champion. That's champion versus champion.
Yeah, if you want to be the best, you have to beat the best. Now, let's take us to this point in the game. As a former boxer yourself, what is it like when you get to the beginning of fight week? How do you get your mind right?
This is all for the media. Everything that's happening right here, we're not going 100%. We're not giving it all. You know, we're not showing what we're going to do inside the ring. It's just 1-2, we're sharp, and we're still trying to make weight. That's another thing. We're trying to make weight. So right now, a little bit of action, a little bit of speed is good, but we're not going to give it all and show it out there. Like right here, she's talking, she's throwing punches really crisp, strong and sharp, but she's not really trying to punch too hard. She just wants to break a little sweat, show the crowd what she's gonna do on Saturday night. You know, they're going over a game plan, but they don't wanna show their game plan. So just a little shake and bake in there. That's it.
Sure, yeah, you definitely don't wanna tip your hand here as we bring in our guy. Smith, thank you so much for joining us, CEO of Matchroom Boxing. And you know, when you look at the card here, you see Katie Taylor, and what does she mean to have someone like this?
It's amazing, you know, what she's already done at such an early stage of her professional career is amazing to see. And I think she's going to go on from here. She's going to become undisputed world champion, move up in the weight divisions, and carry on doing what she does.
No, she's.
You believe me?
No, I definitely believe.
You said that with authority.
Sometimes I like to.
No, she's awesome to watch, and for her to become the third woman in history of boxing, that's a momentous occasion. So how do you feel about that?
Yeah, no, it's amazing. You know, she accomplished so much as an amateur, and she's, you know, in Ireland and the UK, she's an absolute superstar. And I think it's starting to show out here that people respect her skills and what she's done. And for she's such a lovely person as well, you know, speaks so well, very quiet, very sort of understated. So to go in there, and she goes in the ring, she's like a monster. She's like a completely different, but she's like scary, like a completely different person. But I think she's going to accomplish, as you say, what only two other women have done. But then I think she'll go on from there and do much, much more.
Yeah, Frank, when you talk about her very kind and, you know, she's just kind of like mild-mannered, just a low-key demeanor. We saw that in the feature earlier. How do you flip that switch and become just an absolute savage in the ring?
I haven't got a clue because I can't do it.
Me neither.
Maybe I haven't got the fight inside, but it is amazing when you see her. She's so ferocious. You know, every punch she throws, and she's amazing to watch in the ring as well. So, you know, I can't wait for her fight on Saturday night. It's up there with the main event.
No, absolutely. And she's a God-fearing woman, very humble, very soft-spoken, but she's a killer in there, no doubt.
I think as well, you know, Delphine Persoon, she's only had one loss in 9 years. It's a tough test. You know, it's not a foregone conclusion, but I think Katie's skill set is so on another level to all these other, you know, she's amazing. But it's going to be great. Looking forward to that one.
Yeah, speaking of skill set, you see what she's doing right now. I would have about four black eyes. I have two eyes and I would have four black eyes, a bloody nose and a fat lip from that exercise right there alone. Now, we saw the Canelo fight in Vegas earlier this month. It was a spectacle, to say the least. What are some of the biggest differences between having a big fight in Vegas versus here in Manhattan?
It's not quite as sunny.
You guys brought the weather with you.
Yeah, no. We brought this over from the UK, but Vegas is a great place, New York, but the mecca of boxing, to be in Madison Square Gardens, especially for a lot of these fighters to perform in where some greats have performed. They are all so delighted. You know, every fight they have is huge to them, but to come here, New York, Madison Square Gardens, it's going to be a special night for everyone on the card.
That's exactly what we're hoping for. And we obviously saw Katie Taylor there. We know what's
Ladies
going on with the title
one more
card
time,
there, but are there
Katie
any guys
Taylor!
On the undercard that you're excited about
Incredible
seeing?
World champion.
Yeah, I think there's some great fights all the way from top to bottom. You got Tommy Coyle, Chris Algieri is going to be an all-out 12-round war. Tommy Coyle doesn't know how to go and have a fight without having a war, which is great for the viewers. Josh Kelly, Ray Robinson. Josh Kelly stepping up. And, you know, he's a huge talent from the UK, probably one of the best we got. Joshua Buatsi also on the card against Marco Antonio Periban. You've got Callum Smith defending his world titles. I think he's number one, 168 pound in the division, against Hassan Ndam, who brings a tough test. You know, he just beat Martin Murray in the UK. That's a great fight. And I think I'm forgetting one, but the music was so loud, my mind's gone.
No, that was good.
It's hard to think straight over here. Frank, we appreciate you joining us. We're going to listen into Katie Taylor for a minute.
She's the WBC reigning champion. She's coming to business. How do you see this fight happening?
Yeah, Delphine is a fantastic champion, and this is a fight that I wanted from the very start. Really, I want to be involved in the best fights possible, and this is champion against champion, the best versus the best. This is exactly what boxing needs, and I prepared so hard for this fight for the last few months, and I'm ready for Saturday night.
Katie, thank you so much. We look forward to seeing you. Thank you. Katie Taylor, ladies and gentlemen.
All right, Sergio, as we see Katie Taylor there posing in the ring as we kick off fight week here, Anthony Joshua, Andy Ruiz Jr. here in Lower Manhattan. Such an exciting week for fight fans everywhere. The heavyweight title on the line this Saturday right here on DAZN. You'll be able to catch all the undercard fights as well. You just saw what happened with Katie Taylor. How would you evaluate her workout?
Well, like I said, we really don't show you what we have. No game plan being strategized there. It's just we want to stay a little loose. We want to show the crowd what's to come Saturday, but that's just sharpness. It's just for speed. It's not really for power or show. It's just for you guys, for the media, for us, for everyone.
Yeah, we love it. We need shiny things, and I love shiny things. Now, we saw in the 40 Days documentary, as we take a look at the fight card here once again, Callum Smith, Hassan Ndam, that we'll be looking at a little bit later, Katie Taylor, Delphine Parsoon, which I think is going to be something really to look forward to. Obviously, you have the title card here. We talked about this earlier, but as you come across the pond, as I was saying earlier, Anthony Joshua was able to come out earlier. I think it was a couple months ago. You see that in the 40 Days documentary. He trained in Miami. He trained up here in New York. How does that benefit him?
No, it benefits him a lot because he's getting that exposure, that American exposure. And I mean, it's greatness for a heavyweight champion to come across the pond and do what guys like Muhammad Ali around the world defending their championships. So this is a great fighter proving his greatness.
Well, like pinstripes are to Derek Jeter, Ock is to Barack. They are standing by with Katie Taylor. Guys.
Hey, Katie, I'm getting a feeling of like the Christy Martin era, the Layla Ali era. Yeah. Women's boxing is starting to be excited, and you're the main reason. You've been asking for this fight. We talked to your trainer about this fight. It's finally here. Yeah. How do you feel?
Oh, this is amazing to be here. I mean, I'm kind of pinching myself nearly that this fight is only a few days away, fighting for the undisputed championship of the world. And I know the challenge in front of you, I know how big of a challenge it is. And that's why I've trained so hard over these last few years. And I've kind of locked myself away over these last few months in training camp. And I put myself through the trenches every single day for this fight. So I feel ready and prepared. Yeah.
Well, I know y'all. We always see you go crazy in the gym. Yeah. Even just now, like everybody else was smiling when they did it. You were focused. You were really in there, like really hitting the mitts hard.
Yeah, I guess I might as well make the most of this myself and just get a small bit of work out here while I'm here. But But yeah, I mean, just looking at the crowd here, you can't help but be excited about this night and be excited about the fight. And I'm just hyped up right now.
Yeah, and listen, New York has a big, big Irish community. Yeah. So you know they're coming out. I mean, I see them a lot of them here in the stands. Do you feel pressure in performing for them? Not only being on a big stage, even though you fought already at MSG, this is like kind of a big, big stage. All the UK fighters are coming. Do you feel a little pressure?
There's probably a little bit of pressure involved with that, but pressure is a privilege as well. It's great to be in this position, and I'd rather be in this position than not really. This is huge. Fighting for the Undisputed Championship in front of so many Irish people. I've dealt with this pressure before, really, and yeah.
No, you know, a lot of people forget, even Barack and I was talking about, you only have 13 fights and you're on the biggest stage. This is for pound supremacy, in my opinion. But you're up for the task. Like, you know, I mean, I felt like you've been in a sport for years and years.
Yeah, exactly. And that's always been my goal, is to become the Undisputed Champion of the world, to be the number one pound for pound in the world as well. So, but this isn't going to be an easy fight. This is going to be the hardest fight today, no doubt. This is a tough, tough challenge, but these are the kind of fights that I absolutely love as well.
Beautiful, beautiful. Listen, don't forget Katie Taylor this week on DAZN.
Yes, our favorite girl right here.
Here on Saturday, here on DAZN, we obviously have the title card between Anthony Joshua making his American debut here at Madison Square Garden. As once again, we take a look at the fight card here on DAZN. We are kicking off fight week with the fighter workout for Gardner, LG Red, Sergio Mora, the Latin Snake here with you alongside Ak and Barack as well. They're wandering around getting all sorts of great interviews. We took a look at the card there. Callum Smith is coming up here in a few short minutes, but I want to go back to that interview with Katie Taylor. It's so hard not to like her. She is an absolute savage in the ring, but she is a complete sweetheart outside of the ring.
No, she's a God-fearing woman, but she's a beast in there. I mean, may God forgive her how brutal she can be, but she's an Olympic gold medalist. She, in her mind, is about to become the undisputed, only the third woman to win the Undisputed Championship of the world. It's a dream come true. Her prayers answered, but she is a monster in there.
Yeah, she goes for that Undisputed Championship. I actually watched an interview with her earlier where she said that would mean more than her Olympic gold. She's a two-time Olympian, won gold in 2012. She actually got to represent Ireland, carry the flag for her country, and this means more than that, Sergio. That's insane.
No, it really does, because it's history. I mean, this is history. I mean, the Olympics is history. Fighting in Madison Square Garden, where the greats have fought. Muhammad Ali, Joe Frazier, Roberto Duran, Sugar Ray Robinson, and on and on and on. And she could put her name with that greatness. I mean, that's something that you can't replace. And the Olympic gold medal is unforgettable. Every boxer will tell you. Sugar Ray Leonard tells me, you know what? I want all these championships in the world. The thing that means the most to me is standing on that podium, and the national anthem, the flag, everyone, that's the first taste of success that they have. So the Olympic gold medal is everything for any boxer.
The way you describe that just gave me
goosebumps. I got chills too, by the way.
I love that.
I got chills too, by the way.
But when you talk about becoming an undisputed champion, it's not as easy as it sounds. You have to get the promoters together. You have to get the venues in place. There are certain permits that need to be granted in those respective cities. So in order for her to get to this point has to mean so much.
And it took a lot. So not only did it take promoters to get together and Eddie Hearn to do what he does best, and that's bring deals together.
He's the best.
But he is. But it's so political. I mean, boxing is so political. And you know what? The big boys can take a page of what the ladies are doing, because they're fighting each other. They're unifying. They're bringing all the belts together. And you know what? It is apples and oranges as far as business, as money. But still, they're not worried about fighting the best. Bring it on. And one person that has been fighting the best is Anthony Joshua and Katie Taylor.
All right, and with that, we're going to toss it over to Dave Diamante, who's going to be introducing Callum Smith for his fighter workout.
Ladies and gentlemen, from Brookfield Place here in downtown New York City, the open workout continues for Saturday night's historic night of boxing action, taking place at the world's most famous arena, the mecca of sports and entertainment, and of course the mecca of boxing, Madison Square Garden. And I need you guys to hear this and hear me real well. We only have few tickets left, so get to Ticketmaster.com. This is very important. We only have a few tickets left, so get to Ticketmaster and pick up your tickets for the big fight at Madison Square Garden Saturday night. It's an historic night. 9 fights, 6 title fights at the top of the bill. The Unified Heavyweight Championship of the World, Anthony Joshua and Andy Ruiz. And right now, like I said, the open workout continues. The gentleman that we're going to bring in, he is the WBC Diamond Champion. He is the Muhammad Ali Trophy winner. He is the Ring Magazine Super Middleweight Champion of the World and the WBA Super Middleweight World Super Champion of the World. Fighting out of Liverpool, he's one of the 4 famous Fighting Smith brothers. Fighting out of Liverpool, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Callum Mundo Smith. Best 168-pounder on the planet, defending his title Saturday night.
All right, Sergio, what are we seeing here? Once again, I know this is all for the fans and for the media, but how is he looking right now?
Well, Lauren, first of all, do you know what El Mundo means? I mean, that's
the
his
world,
nickname.
Man.
That's right. That's the champion.
Hey, I speak my Espanol. Mira
nomás.
Un poquito.
Mira nomás, Lauren.
Oh,
okay, but that's the
gracias.
Man. That's the champion del mundo. And he's very impressive because he just won, like David DeMonte just said, he won everything and possibly the best 168-pounder in the world that we're watching right here.
Yeah, when you look at what it takes to fight at super middleweight, obviously he's 6'3", pretty tall for this weight class, but some guys are going up to this weight class, including his opponent, Hassan and Dom. What does that mean, and how difficult is it to make that transition?
No, the transition is easy, especially for guys like this. I mean, they fought against the best, both Hassan and Dom and Callum Smith, who just finished beating a great fighter and retiring a great fighter in George Groves. So
sure.
This is greatness in front of us. I mean, he has the path set out for greatness. And if he can stop a guy who's very difficult to stop,
yeah,
and Hassan Adam, I mean, it just speaks the world, or El Mundo, of Callum
El
Smith.
El Mundo, I like how you played that out there. So when they meant workout, they really meant workout. I mean, this dude rolls in, and he is rolling out his legs in the middle of the ring, just in case the fans wanted to know exactly what his process was.
Oh, absolutely. This is it's pretty good. I like
this
that.
This is good. We're getting some
look
yoga.
A little bit of yoga, shadow boxing,
you
stretching.
I appreciate how different this is. When you were fighting, what was it like for you? What was your routine during the fighter workouts?
The fighter workouts
were the dog and pony show.
Yeah, the dog and pony. It was basically just I focused on speed. I focused on staying loose, breaking a little bit of a sweat. Like I said, these guys are still having to make weight. So if I can get a sweat while I can do my promotion and do the dog and pony show,
okay,
and give the media and the fans what they want, that's all great. I mean, I hit everything I need, but obviously you're not going 100%. You're not giving it all you got. You're not showing your cards. It's just basically stay loose and just give you guys a quick little show.
So 2 birds, 1 stone. As you can see, there's quite an audience here. Callum Smith fighting in the U.S. for just the second time. He fought here back in 2014. A little bit of uncharted territory. Is it, from your perspective, is it tough as a fighter when you step into a ring when you may not have that contingency? Obviously, you'll have a lot of fans from the U.K. for Anthony Joshua.
No, the fans always mean something, especially when they get across the pond to come support you. It doesn't matter who they're just supporting, because they're going to support their native land. So, no, it's always exciting. It's always a big deal, especially when you have the big stage in front of you, and it doesn't get bigger than MSG. So it's just, it's greatness all around.
So his trainer, Joe Gallagher, you see him working with him right here, former trainer of the year. What does that mean when you are named trainer of the year? What exactly does that entail?
No, the Gallagher name means a lot in boxing, especially in the UK, but they're just as great as Callum Smith and Anthony Joshua. I mean, they're championship trainers and they're working with the best. And even though, like right here, it doesn't seem like it's much with the with the stretching and the bands here, but this is their routine, and they got to follow routine. They can't just break it because they're in front of a crowd or it's a big fight.
Okay.
Continue doing what you've been doing for the last 6-8 weeks.
And the hat on, it seems like he almost has blinders on. He's trying not to interact too much with the fans. He's trying to stay in the zone, stay focused. He has the earbuds in. And this is normally where we ask you to point out what you see in his form, but I would say that was good form right there. Good shoulder presses, 90-degree angles.
I like the blinders, and I'm going to give you another analogy because he's the thoroughbred. I mean, we got to keep our thoroughbreds in training the same way we've been feeding them, resting them. Everything's the same. So, yes, the blinders are on, the hat is on. Or maybe that's a sponsor. Who knows? Maybe that's
good,
a sponsor. That's
point.
Why he has it on.
You're very right. Okay, as we see him getting into a little cardio portion of the workout here with the jump rope, we talk about his length, we talk about his reach, obviously his height, that's 6'3". How does this give him an added advantage?
Yeah, of course. I mean, size is always an advantage. But if you're fighting fighters like Ndam, who's an Olympian, who's faced tall fighters, short fighters, aggressive, it's not really going to be much of an advantage. Now, if he was fighting a fighter that wasn't as experienced as Ndam, Olympian, stuff like that, absolutely, he could fight behind the jab. But Smith is an excellent body puncher. He can fight on the inside. He can fight on the outside, like he proved against George Groves. I mean, he is really the real deal and all around a complete fighter.
Speaking of Ndam, he was actually Callum Smith's sparring partner before his previous fight. Who gets the advantage there? Is it both? Because you kind of know what their styles are.
That's a great question.
Thank you. Well, every now and again.
No, that's a great question.
I just keep throwing things at the wall and hope something sticks.
From baseball to boxing, that's a great question. No, listen, I hate fighting sparring partners.
Really?
Because I made it a rule, a thumb, not to fight a sparring partner unless I had to.
Okay.
And I only had to do that one time, and I got the knockout. But it's better for Callum Smith because he's a more confident, undefeated fighter. He's the champion. He got to find out the range and the toughness. And we know Ndam's tough. There's no doubt about that.
He wouldn't be here if he wasn't, right?
No, he wouldn't be here. And if you've seen Ndam fight, every time he gets dropped, and he gets dropped a lot, 11 or 12 times I think it's been in his career, he gets up. So this is a guy that's resilient, is tough, he has the experience. But if you've already been in the ring with him in sparring, then you know what to expect, which is an advantage.
Okay, you said that does give Callum Smith an advantage. Now, Ndam, just being put on this card, facing Callum Smith, his old sparring partner, what kind of opportunity is this for him to be fighting on the undercard for such a big heavyweight tilt in the boxing mecca, Madison Square Garden?
It's a huge deal for him, but he's already been to the top. He's fought for a world championship 3 times already, and he came up short against Peter Quillin, David Lemieux, and Ryota Murata. So he's only lost to champions. This is a championship caliber fighter who hasn't been able to cross the line of becoming a champion, but I mean, he has a championship heart, that's for sure. I mean, to be down 11 times and get up, peel yourself off the canvas to keep fighting, that's a champion in my eyes.
If I went down once, I would just play dead. I'd be done. I'd be completely done. Okay, now as we see a little shadow boxing here, you see the reach. What are you noticing about his form and his style?
Well, I like the pivots right off the bat. Look at his feet, how he pivots. He doesn't stand in one place in shadow box.
Yeah.
I always love to see a fighter move around the ring a little bit. You get to know a lot about a fighter, what his style is. Look, see that little pivot right there to the left?
Okay.
And he kept his hands up. Everything's real loose. He's not putting much behind it. He's focused. That's the pivot. I love seeing that.
So you're never going to tip your hand and show your combos here?
No, not at all.
Those look pretty good.
No, they're excellent, but we're not going to show you everything.
Okay, that's fair enough. All right, so you see he has one earbud in. I'm curious for all the fans watching out there here on DAZN. Once again, we are kicking off Fight Week right here on DAZN. Anthony Joshua, Andy Ruiz Jr., we are watching the fighter workouts. Lauren Gardner, Sergio Mora here with you. We also have Achim Brock wandering around here in Lower Manhattan. Callum Smith now in the middle of his fighter workout. Talking about the music. Would you ever do this? And if you did, what was your go-to music?
I will never dance to techno or house. I just despise it. But my music would be R&B. I want something smooth. I want it relaxed. I want something that the audience probably wouldn't like. Like Hall & Oates. I love shadow boxing to soft music.
Hall & Oates, I would have never guessed that.
Baby hair.
Thank you so much.
With a woman's eye.
My life is now complete. Sergio Mora singing Hall & Oates, and as we watch Callum Smith in the middle of his fighter workout, he is on the card for this big Anthony Joshua, Andy Ruiz Jr. card.
Anthony Triple G.
And you saw it right there. Speaking of goosebumps, two big fights in two consecutive weeks right here on DAZN. Lauren Gardner, Sergio Mora here with you in Lower Manhattan as we kick off the big fight week for Anthony Joshua, who makes his American debut at Madison Square Garden. Callum Smith was just working out. He's now standing by with Auchan Brock.
All right, so you look next to you look like a cruiserweight, man. Your size is so overwhelming, especially with guys at 168, you know. This is an important fight. How could you be focused on this fight and not thinking about the Canelo fight that everybody's talking about, the possibility of a mega fight with Canelo? There has to be some distraction there.
Yeah, but the fight you're speaking about with Canelo, I slip up Saturday night, they don't happen, they're gone. So that keeps me motivated. I have to come through this weekend to keep them possible massive, massive fight alive. So I'm fully focused on June 1st and it's exciting to be entering the ring as a world champion for the first time, so that's given me a little buzz as well. So I'm in a good place. I've had a very good training camp and I'm ready to perform.
Listen, I know winning the Muhammad Ali Trophy was an amazing moment, but what about winning at Madison Square Garden?
Yeah, it's another amazing moment and that's what I'm in boxing for. I want big nights, I want big fights, and winning the tournament in Jeddah was a special night, and though defending my world title successfully at Madison Square Garden will be just as special. So with that, that's what's keeping me in boxing. There's stuff that excites me, stuff that motivates me, and Madison Square Garden definitely does that.
And you know, a lot of people are overlooking Salman Dan. He's a former world champ. He's been in there with the likes of Kid Chocolate. He's won big fight, coming off a big victory. So, I mean, and he's a southpaw. Like, how hard was it getting prepared for him?
Yeah, exactly. You know, he's a good opponent. He's an experienced opponent. He's a former world champion, and only the very best have beat him. I believe I'm one of the very best, so I should be good enough to beat him. But it's no easy fight. He's a very good, tough customer, and I'm expecting a tough night. But I'm fully prepared. I'm prepared for the best possible version, Hassan and Dam. And I just believe the best version of me turns up, I beat any version of him.
All right, so you're in New York. Are you driving around like sightseeing, saying, "Oh my God, look at this, look at that," or are you just totally focused on the fight?
No, I've been before, and I'm fully focused on the fight. And hopefully, once the fight's out the way, I'll do a little bit of sightseeing. But I'm here to do a job. It's not a holiday; right. it's work, and I'm fully focused on Saturday night, and then we'll do some sightseeing.
You know, the American audience wants to know who we're gonna adopt from the UK. There's so many UK fighters fighting on Saturday night. So, are you gonna outshine the rest of them?
Hopefully, you know, I think everyone on the show wants to steal the headlines and hopefully get a good knockout or an impressive win. But it's a very good show. Some of Britain's best on show. Katie Taylor's a special talent. She's fighting for the undisputed title at lightweight in the women's boxing. And Josh Kelly's a great prospect. Joshua Batty's a great prospect. And Tommy Cooley is a very good fight. It's an interesting one. And it's a good show from a fight fan, in my opinion. But I'll be looking to hopefully steal the headlines.
Let me tell you how we look at you over here in America. We say, listen, he's a great 168-pound fighter. He could fight everybody there, or wait for the Canelo fight, or go up to 175. Which one do you like better?
I don't know. I believe I can do both. I can believe I'd say 168, fight some of the other champions, hopefully wait for the Canelo fight, and then when I'm fully satisfied, then move to 175. 175 is definitely a possibility, but there's still stuff to achieve at 168, so I'll stay at 168 for as long as I can.
But, I mean, if you do have it to move up to 75, who do you think will be your toughest task there?
I don't know. I was speaking about this a couple of days ago. I think 175 is a very good division. It's very interesting because there's no standout number one. They're all probably as good as each other, and if they were all to the four champions to enter the tournament, I don't know who I'd back to win it. They're all pretty good and pretty similar, but it's a very good division and one that I'd look forward to entering in a year or two's time. But 168 my division now, and I want to stamp the authority on.
You got to take care of Nassim Hassan Andam on Saturday. Good luck on Saturday night. Looking forward to you. This is going to be a sleeper. I think that fight is going to be one of the best fights of the night.
Thanks a lot, guys. I guarantee will be one of the best fights of the night still to come. The heavyweights are about to work out here as we kick off fight week in Lower Manhattan before the big event at MSG on Saturday night. Andy Ruiz Jr. and Joshua Anthony. Anthony Joshua, rather. And find out how he got here. Let's check out a promo for 40 days.
Anthony Joshua is big, strong, and experienced.
He was viewed as the next Lennox Lewis.
He's the best finisher in the game.
He's the biggest boxing attraction in all of Europe. He's the total package.
In order to be recognized as a world champion, you have to be recognized in the world.
I was in camp, feeling like the motherfucking heavyweight champ.
In boxing, they say there's no place to hide. That's what I'm gonna find out.
Cause you know I ain't scared.
And let me tell you, I watched the first episode. It was incredible. You can catch episode 2 tonight right here on DAZN and episode 3 on Thursday. All right, to introduce Andy Ruiz Jr., let's bring in David Diamante.
Ladies and gentlemen, we are absolutely delighted to welcome everyone here to Brookfield Place in New York City for the open workout for Saturday night's historic night of boxing action taking place at the world's most famous arena, the Mecca of sports and entertainment, and the Mecca of boxing, Madison Square Garden. Ladies and gentlemen, it's all being brought to you courtesy of Mr. Eddie Hearn of Matchroom Boxing USA, and this bout will be in association with AJ Boxing and TGB Promotions. We're sponsored by William Hill, StubHub, Tecate, the official beer of boxing, Hennessy, Never Stop, Never Settle, and JD Sports. Now, ladies and gentlemen, all the action will be broadcast live around the world on Sky Sports and DAZN. And ladies and gentlemen, right now we've got the challenger in the ring for the main event for Saturday night. Please welcome. He's fighting 12 rounds for the WBA, IBF, and WBO and IBO championships of the world. Please welcome from Imperial, California, the former WBO Intercontinental and NABF heavyweight champion, Andy the Destroyer Ruiz.
Okay, Sergio, here he is, Andy Ruiz Jr., obviously a late add to the card after Jarrell Miller failed 2 drug tests for performance-enhancing substances. But this guy, the body aside, as Eddie Hearn was saying, is an absolute competitor.
Yeah, he is, and he has fast hands. I mean, he's a big man with fast hands. And you know what? Miller was a big man with fast hands, too, and fast feet. So this is a good replacement, even though it was last minute and a lot of people were panicking. Eddie Hearn, like you said, he was a promoter panicking. He wanted this opportunity. Andy Ruiz needed this opportunity. And his last fight versus Alexander Dmitrenko, he's the same size as Joshua. So he's coming off of someone, fighting a big man, and he wanted this opportunity. I mean, this is big for him.
He wore him down there in the 5th round, and it ended up with the decision. Now, the quick turnaround, how can that hurt or benefit him? Now, I was listening and watching a lot of interviews where he was saying, you know what, I trained for 10 weeks leading up to that fight, and now I'm back in the gym, I'm already in shape, I'm good to go. He says it gives me the advantage.
No, it does give him the advantage. I mean, for a heavyweight, especially a heavyweight, nowadays only fight about 2 times a year. This is unprecedented.
Okay.
Andy Ruiz fought 45 days ago, something like that, to fight for the world championship, the unified heavyweight championship of the world versus a stud, a superstar like Anthony Joshua. It's like the Mexican-American Rocky story right here.
Yeah.
It really is.
And you've never had a Mexican-American heavyweight champion. So it has to be so special for him just to be able to be in this arena.
No, it really is. The only one who got close to that is Chris Arreola, and he was ultimately stopped by Klitschko, another big man that Joshua was able to fight and take out. But this is an impressive young man. If you talk to him, very smart, very articulate, He had an amateur pedigree, so that's another thing. He had over 100 amateur fights, which is more than AJ himself. So he has an amateur pedigree. He's only once beaten against Joseph Parker, a man that Joshua couldn't take out. So, I mean, this is the real deal. I mean, this is a guy that if anyone has to replace a last-minute replacement, this is as good as it gets with Andy Ruiz.
Okay, so let's just address the elephant in the room. You have Anthony Joshua, who's built basically like an Adonis. He is chiseled. And you have Andy Ruiz Jr., who his physique isn't exactly what you would expect in a professional boxer. I read something that he blamed fast food for everything. But does that really hinder him at all?
Hey, not for nothing, and I hate to keep bringing up his name, but Big Baby Miller didn't have the body either. I mean,
he didn't have
the physique. It's not about physique in this sport. It's about the heart. I mean, as cliche as it is, heart, it's the mentality, how prepared you are, how hungry you are. Ultimately, it's how hungry you are, and this man's hungry, and he has a great trainer in his corner as well. So, look, he hits all the buttons for me, for him to shock the world. Now, of course, it's going to be an uphill battle for him to do that, but he's ready. He wanted this opportunity, and now he's here.
Okay, you mentioned his trainer, Manny Robles. Just give us a little insight into his reputation.
I've known Manny Robles for years.
Really?
Over 15 years, and he's been in there. He started from the bottom, and now he's here. So it's a big...
Thank you so much.
Actually, that's pretty
so
good.
So happy you threw that in there.
You know what? It really is a big
Not
deal for...
Notes.
It really is a big deal for a trainer like Manny Robles, because he put in his work, and he's had a lot of champions and prospects and contenders, and now he's on the big stage fighting for the biggest championship of the world. So it's a dream come true for both these gentlemen.
In the biggest venue, and so much on the line as far as reputation for him, for his family, for his countrymen as a Mexican-American. Now, just take us into that mindset. What is it like when, and I know this may have never happened to you where you're just put on the spot, but how do you kick things into sixth gear and get ready for this type of thing?
It just, I mean, it's what you dream for as a kid. I mean, Andy Ruiz will tell you that this is a dream come true, not only for him and his trainer, but it's an opportunity of a lifetime. You can't let this go. These are moments that you have to take advantage of. And you're not doing it for the money. You're doing it for the prestige. You're doing it for the doors that it can open. You're doing it for history. Muhammad Ali fought here. Joe Frazier fought here. Roberto Duran, Sugar Ray Robinson, Jake LaMotta.
Keep going. It was good.
I'll keep going if you want. But now you can add Andy Ruiz to that. I mean, it's just, those are the things we dream of as youngsters, as amateurs. And now he's here. That's his moment.
It's early in the week.
I got chills again, by the way.
I know. I love what's happening here. We're getting pumped up for the main event that will be on Saturday. But right now, the fighter workouts, you see the turnout, which is absolutely incredible. Here in Lower Manhattan, we can see the Statue of Liberty from where we're standing right now. This is an absolute epic event. A great way to kick off Fight Week right here on DAZN. You can catch everything. Once again, sign up. Just do it. If you don't have it right now, you'll catch Triple G next month. Be right here at Madison Square Garden on June 8th. All it boils down to, if you sign up for the year membership, $8.33. That's as much as a Starbucks costs here in New York, Sergio. So my favorite moment early in this week was last night when Ruiz Jr.'s son saw the poster, and he was in awe of his dad. How cool is that?
Oh, that's a dream come true for a father and a son. And I got to say, you know, as a father myself, it really is a dream come true for your son to see on the big stage, to see fans, so many people admiring you and seeing your posters everywhere.
Yeah.
I mean, all a little kid knows is King Kong in New York. But this is a heavyweight. This is a big man. This is his father.
Yeah.
Being like King Kong to his son. So it really is a touching moment to see, and a heart puller, and you can bet that it's going to motivate Andy Ruiz.
Yeah, I just love that special bond. We saw that with Daniel Jacobs and his son earlier this month in Vegas at the Canelo fight, and how tight they are. I can only imagine that's what Ruiz Jr. and his son are like. And, you know, when it comes to family on Fight Week, can you just give me a little bit of insight? Do you keep them close to you, or do you kind of separate yourself?
That's a great question. That's two great questions, by the way, Lauren.
Thank you.
Normally, we have a boxing camp because we want to stay away from our family, because we want to avoid that heart tug. We want to avoid being sentimental. We want to do the opposite, preparing for a guy that wants to take our head off. We want to be mean. Sure. We want to be chiseled. We want to be hungry. And we can't be soft, because a kid... Sorry, I had to get interrupted there by Mr. David
Damian. The Destroyer Ruiz.
He just has
such a great booming voice.
Nice round of applause out here. Man.
Okay, we're going to listen in. Title card, Andy Ruiz Jr., the late ad, which will be a great heavyweight tilt at Madison Square Garden, the mecca of boxing here in Manhattan. It's going to be a great fight. Let's take a look. It's going to be.
Anthony Joshua launches himself into the sporting elite. Joshua nails him with a left hand, wide in trouble already. Anthony Joshua, Vladimir Klitschko.
Who's going to stop Joshua now?
Well, we're kicking off fight week here in the Big Apple. You just saw Andy Ruiz Jr. in his fighter workout. He is standing by with Auk and Brock.
All right, Andy, it's safe to say you're not dehydrated. You're sweating, man. A little workout there. You know, a lot of fighters that are underdog always love the fact that they're underdogs. I'm okay with that. But a part of you has to be a little annoyed with the fact that nobody's giving you a shot.
Yeah, you know what? Everybody's been doubting me since I was training, you know what? But look at where I came. I came so far, coming from a small town, a small city. And you know what? I'm doing great things now, you know, fighting for the world champion of the world. And, you know, I'm here to make history and become the first Mexican heavyweight champion.
Listen, you got a country behind you. You got underdog status. Like, it must be a lot of pressure on you.
Yeah, there's a lot of pressure on me, but I think Anthony Joshua has more to lose, you know? He's fighting a dangerous fighter like me. I think I'm a better opponent than everyone else that they had picked, but you know what? It's going to be a hard fight, but I'm here to win it all.
Well, in my opinion, it's going to be a hell of an entertaining fight. I want to wish you good luck on Saturday. You deserve the moment.
Thanks, Andy Ruiz.
Thanks a lot, guys. Yeah, very likable guy there, Andy Ruiz Jr. And he talks the talk. The question is, can he walk the walk, Sergio?
You know what? He's a bright young man. I mean, he's self-aware and he's self-reflective. I believe in his heart, he believes he can. And ultimately, that's all that matters in a fighter's heart. Can he really do it? Does he believe in himself? And this is like a Rocky-type story. So do I believe him? We'll have to see. But more importantly, does he believe? That's all that matters.
Yeah, we're just moments away from Anthony Joshua and his fighter workout as we kick off fight week here in Lower Manhattan. Lauren Gardner, Sergio Mora here with you, a.k.a. the Latin Snake. Once again, I'm very jealous of that nickname. But let's circle back to Andy Ruiz. We just watched his workout. What'd you make of it? How'd he look?
Well, look, we're not going to expect a chiseled body like we are with AJ, and we know that, but he is a fighter with a lot of experience. He had over 100 fights as an amateur. He only has one loss versus a champion in Parker, so this is a fighter that deserves to be here, really.
Sure.
Does, and He is a top contender. He has fast hands, and he has a lot of heart, and he has a great trainer in his corner in Manny Robles. So I just feel they're ready for this opportunity, and it's a last-minute replacement, so it can't get better than this man right here.
Yeah, I completely agree with you. I was watching some of his interviews, and he was saying that he was studying film of Mike Tyson because he wants to get in on AJ, whereas AJ is going to try and keep Andy on the outside. What kind of a strategy is that?
Well, he's not going to be Mike Tyson, but he can be a better version of Andy Ruiz and still a page from Tyson.
Okay.
But ultimately, greatness is right in front of him. It's time for him to get it.
Okay, once again, we are just moments away from the Anthony Joshua fighter workout. Fans on hand. And Sergio, I have to say, I'm really impressed with this turnout. As you know, I'm still relatively new to all of this stuff, so you're seeing it through my eyes, which is a lot of fun. Is this normal to have this kind of turnout for fighter workouts?
It is when it's raining.
Good point.
No, but not for nothing. We are in New York City.
Amen.
And this is the heavyweight championship of the world versus a stud, a handsome stud at that. That's why you see so many female fans here as well. And not only that, but look at the shopping. We're around some high-class shopping and high-class boxing.
I know. So we can go get ourselves a nice outfit, maybe a purse, some overpriced coffee while we're at it.
I got overpriced cigars right now.
Oh, you did?
At Davidoff.
Look at you. Yeah. You did a little shopping in between.
And Ferragamo's right behind us, my favorite.
So here we go. And if you want to advertise with us, Ferragamo, why don't you hit us up at DAZN _USA on Twitter as we're just moments away from Anthony Joshua and his workout. The anticipation is building. And I talked about addressing an elephant in the room as Andy Ruiz Jr. was working out, Sergio, but I want to talk about Deontay Wilder, because that has been a lot of the talk already throughout fight week. People are wanting Anthony Joshua to take him on.
What Wilder did in his last fight was amazing. I mean, for him to get that highlight knockout, possibly going to be knockout of the year if it's not a contender already. I mean, it was impressive, and it really puts pressure for AJ to come out here and try to get something similar. It's going to be hard to top that knockout.
Yeah.
But if he can get a knockout versus a fighter like Ruiz, who's never been stopped, that'll still be a big thing, and it could continue the momentum for this undisputed heavyweight championship of the world. It's going to be a tall task for Joshua, but I think he can do it.
Yeah, Ruiz is definitely a big boy, and to knock someone like that out, you don't have to be an expert to know that's going to be a very tough task. Based on what you've seen so far, and you being an expert in this sport, what's your estimation? How are you guessing this thing's going to go?
I think it's going to go similar to his fight with Joshua's fight with Povetkin.
Okay.
He struggled a little bit earlier because this is a fighter in Ruiz who knows how to fight taller fighters. So Povetkin, who was a little older but fought many fighters over 6'5", did really well against Povetkin. And then it took Joshua a little. Actually, I think he broke his nose in that. Joshua had was bleeding.
Oh,
he
wow.
was stumbled a little bit.
Yes.
But he picked himself up like champions do. And he was able to come back and get the sensational knockout over a fighter who's never been stopped. He has the same task in hand here with Ruiz. Maybe with someone that's never been stopped, someone that's going to come in to fight, and possibly someone that could give him trouble early in the early rounds.
I'm glad you mentioned that moment, because you can catch that on demand right here on DAZN. Sugar Ray Leonard hosts Anthony Joshua's Top 10 Moments, and that is inside of that feature. And it is so incredible to watch the stamina and how he's able to regroup himself and get back out there and take him on, as we watch David Diamante patiently standing there as we await Anthony Joshua to make his entrance here as we kick off fight week right here on DAZN for the heavyweight tilt between Andy Ruiz Jr. and Anthony Joshua. We see all the fans here. Just take us back to your fighting days, Sergio. I mean, what was it like to know that you had a contingent of fans out here to support you in pursuing your dreams and your goals?
You know, it all depends. If you're in your hometown, then you know you see familiar faces, and you know that it's your people, it's your family, it's your fan base. But Andy Ruiz is not from New York, and neither is Anthony Joshua. And these are strangers in front of him. So ultimately, it's not phasing them. They're just moving. They're shaking. This is business as usual.
Yeah.
And there's no pressure on them. This is a big moment, the big stage, and this is what they trained for their entire lives.
Okay, we heard rumors that perhaps Anthony Joshua would be arriving via some sort of a seaward vessel to kind of represent him coming over across the Atlantic from the UK. But obviously, there's some inclement weather. I did see a yacht pull up that said Namaste, and I was like, you think it's AJ? Probably not. I don't think it was.
I hope it's AJ. That would be a hell of an entrance.
That would be baller.
showing up in a yacht. But, you know, as you watch The 40 Days, which is produced by Meek Mill, and he does such a tremendous job with his documentary in episode one. Episode two airs tonight, and episode three will be on Thursday, just basically chronicling the journey to this fight and to making his American debut. He talks about as he's running along the beach in Miami, how he likes to be at peace and he likes to be present. I mean, how important is that when you step into a ring?
Tap. Peace and presence.
Yeah, and just
very
to be
important.
Present in the moment and to kind of, I guess, get your head right. Like, I'm big into meditating, and it seems like he kind of is as well.
You know,
the whole namaste thing in here.
You know,
full circle.
You know how I get my head right before a fight, and you're not going to believe me, shopping.
What?
I swear.
Are you kidding?
I'm not kidding.
Okay. Retail therapy.
I go shopping. I go by myself.
Okay.
Sometimes I go with my team, but I like walking around the mall. I like eating and then walking it off around the mall, shopping. Absolutely. I mean, that's how I kind of self-reflect and focus on the task at hand. I know that sounds weird, but for the big fights, you need to stay as calm as possible, really.
Yeah, I love that. The retail therapy. All right, here we are on DAZN. Lauren Gardner, Sergio Mora at the Fighter Workouts as we kick off Fight Week. All right, here's the deal, guys. It is fight night. It is coming up on Saturday. If you don't have the app, if you're on your free trial, make sure you hop on, you download it now. All you have to do is get the year subscription. It basically, I think it parcels out to $8.33 a month. That includes all the big fights. We talk about 40 days. You get to watch all the great add-ins, the documentaries, the countdowns, all the other fights that DAZN has here. And, of course, this is going to be my shameless plug of the day. Change up on DAZN. We have a partnership with Major League Baseball. Think Red Zone for baseball. My friends, myself, Adnan Virk will be on there tonight. Scott Rogowski's also there. Tony Luffman. We have a great time. It's really Red Zone for baseball with like a talk show mixed in there. So if you want to watch goofy people sitting on their couch talking baseball, it's so much fun. We have live look-ins, whip-arounds, highlights, the whole bit. But here we are in Lower Manhattan as we take a look at the June 1st DAZN fight card. Sergio Mora, Lauren Gardner here with you. Some great fights to look forward to on Saturday.
Absolutely. Callum Smith, who's been shocking the world, and in my opinion, just like David Diamante said, we are watching the best 168-pounder in the world, I believe, because the way he dismantled and destroyed a really great champion like George Groves was just impressive. The way he kept his distance, the body shots, the left hooks,
yeah.
He just did everything right. So we're really watching some of the greatest fighters in the world, and Katie Taylor, Callum Smith, Anthony Joshua, and some prospects coming up, just like Josh Kelly and Joshua Butasi, and of course, a former champion and a stud like Chris Algieri.
That was such a good breakdown. And for those of you watching at home, on your tablets, on your phones, here comes the champ as we toss it over to David.
You got the heavyweight champion, Lauren, coming down here. Make some noise!
Ladies and gentlemen, Saturday night, June 1st, Madison Square Garden, brought to you by Eddie Hearn of Matchroom Boxing USA, TGB Promotions, in association with AJ Boxing. Please welcome the Olympic gold medalist, the 22-0 fighter, 21 knockouts, the officer of the Order of the British Empire, and the reigning, defending WBA, IBF, WBO, and IBO champion of the world, AJ Anthony Joshua! Joshua!
Thank you.
Sergio, officer of the British Empire, adored by friends across the globe. I'm sure this is a great welcome for Anthony Joshua as he entered the ring here for Fighter Workouts as we kick off Fight Week here on DAZN. The man, the myth, the legend, the main attraction, Anthony Joshua, man of the people, Sergio.
Yeah, but he must be a little disappointed with that chant. I mean, this is definitely not the way British do it.
He's trying to get people into it.
Yeah,
hang on.
Better get them into
it. Let's listen in for a second. Let's see if we can improve. You want to help?
Here we go. Okay. Sweet Caroline.
Oh. That was much better.
That was better than the first.
Yeah, I like that a lot better. He seems happy with it. He's going to put his gloves on.
But notice how AJ had to go and get them going. They didn't like that first part.
Well, you know, I think this is the culprit. We are in Mets and Yankees territory. This song is played at Red Sox games after a win. So maybe there is an allegiance to their baseball team.
There you go with your baseball conspiracy
theories. Once again, tune in, change up on DAZN. Weeknights and weekdays. You have the Cespedes Barbecue guys here with you. But as we see him lacing up his gloves. I mean, on a scale of one to awesome, how good was that intro?
No, this is a big moment for him right here. It's, he's in the States. He's being tied up here. This is business as usual for AJ. He knows this is promotion.
Yeah, he's getting ready for it. You know, he knows exactly what he's doing. He's able to go over and hang out with the fans, and we hear him kind of mic'd up over there with our handheld camera with the boom, and it just seems like he kind of has it all. He's good with the fans. He's a good fighter.
That's exactly what I touched on at Wembley. He does everything right. He's a self-promoter. He's a unified champion of the world. He's handsome. He's charismatic. He does. He says everything right. He plays to the fans. It's just incredible. He's a total package, really.
It's good to be AJ, is what you're saying. It is very good to be AJ as we're here in Lower Manhattan watching him get his gloves put on, taped up, ready for his fighter workout as we kick off Fight Week right here on DAZN. Anthony Joshua, obviously the main attraction here on the title card, taking on Andy Ruiz Jr., Lauren Gardner, Sergio Mora, here with you, guiding you all the way through the fighter workouts. We have Ock and Brock standing by with various interviews throughout this afternoon. Now, I see him getting taped up. We saw Callum Smith. He went out there and he was doing calisthenics. This looks a little bit more serious.
Yeah, well, this is a big man throwing big punches, so he has to protect them big hands.
Okay, that's fair enough. Is that how you would go about your business?
No, I'm not a big man, and I got small hands, sorry to say. But I still protect them, so yes, I would get taped up and do all that. Matter of fact, I do calisthenics, too. I do my stretching. I do all that.
You would? Okay. So, like you said, business as usual. I see him interacting with the media, answering questions. You don't see this often with fighters. You don't see this often with athletes when they're trying to get in the zone. This guy kind of knows what's going on. He's good about this.
He's very good. He's a superstar. And like we mentioned earlier, he does everything right. And, from Olympic gold medal to unifying the heavyweight title to being on commercials and smiling, saying all the right things, staying away from trouble, being a good role model, a great role model.
And
just doing it all with a wink and a smile. This is the heavyweight champion of the world and how he's supposed to represent the title. And it really is impressive.
Yeah, you talked about being across the pond and covering him. It sounds like he can't walk down the street in the UK without being mobbed by fans. That's how recognizable this man is. Just give us a sense of how much people over in England and really the UK as a whole just adore him.
Well, first of all, I'm not 6'5" and handsome like he is, so I can go through a crowd easily. But that's a man that he really stands out because not only his stature and his size and his physique, and he says everything right, but that's the champ. I mean, the champ is here, and it's just exciting. He does and says everything right. He exudes that superstar, and he is a superstar.
Yeah, the champ has arrived. You saw Andy Ruiz Jr. You were able to watch, a little bit of his tape in his previous fights. What's going to be the biggest challenge for AJ on Saturday when it comes to Ruiz Jr.?
The the momentum, the fact that he's switching opponents, and he was amped to fight a fighter in Miller who was talking a lot of trash, a lot
we
of rubbish. He was talking
conference.
A lot of rubbish in the
so
press
funny.
Conference.
It was so funny. Telling your mom jokes.
You know what? We're watching the landlord here. He came to the States to collect the rent. He calls himself the landlord.
I like that. But, is that a Snatch reference?
I don't know.
Guy Ritchie Snatch. I thought you were going full on UK.
No. That's what Anthony Joshua said. So.
Did you see that? He just went over there and just got the fans completely into this. You see the phones out. You hear the cheers. Here in Lower Manhattan as we kick off Fight Week. So fun to watch. He looks like he's having a great time, huh?
And that's what makes him a star. Normally, a heavyweight champion. For instance, let's say Deontay Wilder comes out here. You think he's going to be playing to fans like this and
nope.
smiling and looking at cameras and winking and flirting and doing what he's doing right now and still giving you the show, popping hard.
Yeah.
No, and that's a distinction between both these guys. We got the good guy and the bad guy. But guess what? That's also what sells. That's
yeah.
also what sells. I mean, these are two massive, big, undefeated heavyweight champions marinating a great fight.
What is it going to take for him to get in a ring with Deontay Wilder, assuming he gets by Ruiz Jr., which obviously we can't assume anything in this world because there's a reason why they step in the ring in the first place.
You can't assume nothing in boxing, and you can't take nothing for granted. That's why you can't over-marinate fights, because sometimes one fight, even a bad performance, say it's a bad performance
okay.
that AJ gets a cut or an injury,
yes.
that's still going to have to delay the fight as well. And say Wilder takes another fight and he's disappointed and he loses or gets injured or hurt, and then that fight goes from to being made in 2020 to 2021, and then the whole aura of it disappears. So
yeah.
that's why you have to really be scientific about it, and you have to have luck. So everything has to line up perfectly, and they don't want to ruin that. So after this fight, I hope it gets made.
Okay, I want to ask you something, because speaking of aura and you know things being time sensitive, we know that the shelf life for fighters isn't exactly that long. And that's something that AJ addressed in the 40 Days documentary, which you can catch right here on DAZN. Executive producer Meek Mill, he's actually in the episode one, and they're down in Miami, and AJ is
winking and smiling
to Meek
us.
Mill. He just came over and gave you a wink.
That's
he's flirting with you.
No, he's because he. This is what he does. He's like, sure, he reminds me of Sugar Ray Leonard in a lot of ways.
Yeah.
And I know him Ray for a lot of years. He knows how to play to the crowd. He knows how to wink and smile and just let you know that I see you. I see
yeah.
you. He's like a man. He's like Jay-Z at a concert.
Yes.
Saying, I see you up there. I see you up there. And he's making fans in the nosebleed feel like they actually are part of the concert.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
You're
That's
right.
exactly what a superstar does.
He's a politician, shaking hands, kissing babies, circling back to, before we're so rudely interrupted by the man of the hour, Anthony Joshua, winking at you, by the way. Tremendous moment within this show already. And Sergio, you sang Hall & Oates, and you talked about your pre-fight routine of shopping, which I think it takes a real man to admit those things, so kudos to you.
Thanks for bringing that up.
You're
again.
Welcome. I'll circle back. Maybe we'll get to sing some more before we wrap this whole thing up. But he's talking to Meek Mill, and he said the shelf life for a fighter isn't that long, and he always wants to make sure he doesn't have any regrets, and that when that generation following him comes in, he doesn't resent them. Hey, how do you take that approach?
That just goes to show you how smart and cerebral Anthony
yeah.
Joshua really is. He's thinking about the post-boxing. He's thinking about the long run, and he knows that boxers don't have a long run. We have a short window, like you said. Only fighters that are defensive can last long. And in the heavyweight division, defense is not their strong point.
Ladies and gentlemen, one more time, the reigning, the defending, the undefeated WBA. Defending his title, Andrew Ruiz. Get your tickets now. Very limited at Madison Square Garden, the mecca of boxing. All brought to you courtesy of Mr. Eddie Hearn of Matchroom Boxing in association with AJ Boxing and TGB Promotions. All the action live around the world on DAZN. Download the app now and Sky Sports Box Office in the United Kingdom. The heavyweight champion of the world, ladies and gentlemen, Anthony Joshua.
Thank you.
meet and greet, part concert, part workout. What did you make of that? It was short, it was sweet, but he was exactly who we thought he was going to be.
It's short and sweet, and that's exactly what these big fights demand. You know, you gotta sell the fight, even though this fight is sounding great, just fine. But this is what you do as a fighter, as a part of the promotion.
Yeah.
And you know what? You gotta give back to the fans as well. So, you know, these are fans that understand that there's a big deal, a big heavyweight champion across the pond, and they wanna see him live in person. And they can't believe they're getting a show like this with a wink and a smile and the whole politician, the shaking hands and kissing babies, like you said. So good.
He's the man. As he continues to do that, he's over there addressing the media. I don't think there will be any unanswered questions for AJ from the media, which is, it's really cool to see, because you don't see that often with a star of his caliber, Sergio. So this was a very pleasant surprise as a fan of sports to see his demeanor.
Look at him yelling to the crowd, playing to the media. Yes, he's turned every single promotional stone he had to actually turn over. This is an impressive young man and a great champion.
Yeah, having the time of his life as he's getting ready for an interview with Sky Sports. We'll have Achim Barak with him shortly thereafter, and we will give you every single second of that interview. As we kick off fight week here in Lower Manhattan, see Anthony Joshua right there, who will be taking on Andy Ruiz Jr. right here exclusively on DAZN. Lauren Gardner, Sergio Mora here with you. And Sergio, let's take a look at the company that Anthony Joshua will be in, taking as a notable heavyweight champion fighting at MSG. How cool is that? That's good company to keep.
That is great company. Great company to keep. Rocky Marciano, Muhammad Ali, Joe Frazier, Joe Lewis. I mean, and now Anthony Joshua. It's just incredible. It's incredible.
It really is. And, you know, I think you can speak to this much more than I can. But when you look at boxing in the heavyweight division, it seems like it kind of tapered off there for a little while. But now you're seeing this resurgence. How nice is that as not only a fan of boxing, but as someone who has fought in the past?
No, the heavyweight division needed this because, look, boxing can't survive without the heavyweight division. That's just a fact. I mean, heavyweights are what the casual fan want to watch. And especially if you get guys like Wilder and Anthony Joshua, who are knocking guys out.
Yeah.
And they're doing it with such charisma. I mean, you got Wilder. You can't go anywhere without listening and hearing bomb squad and scaring the hell out of people, anyone near him. But he backs it up in the ring. He backs it up, especially in his last fight, knocking out. I mean, that's just incredible. And then you have Anthony Joshua, who's the total opposite of a Wilder. Classy, smile, the politician, kissing babies, doing all that. So you got the good, the bad, the white, the black, you got everything, the contrast of everything. So it's just incredible. It really is incredible watching these two.
Yeah, the quintessential British gentleman making his way across the Atlantic, making his American debut. I think it's safe to say he's made a very good impression. I think so too. I absolutely agree with you. We're really looking forward to this heavyweight tilt that's happening on Saturday. And you know, Sergio, after everything you've seen today, as we're beginning to wrap up these fighter workouts, where we're waiting for Achim Barak to catch up with Anthony Joshua, what stood out most to you?
You know, I'll be honest with you. I just like the way that Anthony Joshua really handles himself. I know that he's a great fighter and a great politician and great at marketing and selling and promoting himself. But the fact that he's able to do it time and time and time again with the same wink, the same smile, I mean, it really is impressive to watch, and fighters take notes, because this is something, that's how you sell yourself. That's how you prepare yourself for the long run, to do things after boxing. And it really is impressive watching it time and time again.
Sure, the charisma, the demeanor, and it's all happening right here on Tuesday. But we fast forward to Saturday. That's when you really have to get dialed in. So when do you start to turn that corner? And I know you have to balance some of the promotional stuff, but
how do you start to slowly kind of just get dialed in for fight night?
That's another.
I don't know what this means.
That's three great questions coming
from you.
Thank you.
Are we keeping a tally? I need like a ding.
Because that's really important, and you have there is a technique to it. You start to taper down after the weigh-in. The weigh-in is the most intense part of it, and the adrenaline, because that's the first time you watch your opponent's eyes. You look up to him and you feel like, look at him and you size them up.
I'm scared already. I know you're retired.
The crowd, I'm sorry.
I forfeit.
I'm channeling my weigh-in.
It was good. I loved it.
But the stare down is intense. Yeah. The chills in your body and the crowd, and it's the last time you're going to see your opponent until you actually fight. So then that's when you go back to your room and calm everything down, and you realize now it's time. All the anger, all the promotion, all the kissing babies and doing all this is out the window.
Yeah.
Now it's time to just focus, channel everything that I've done for 8 weeks, and make it happen tomorrow night.
Now that you mentioned that, about how like everything and adrenaline's at an all-time high for the weigh-in, Daniel Jacobs, I remember when he came into that production meeting with us, our entire TV crew, with DAZN, and it was following the weigh-in with Canelo Alvarez, and they kind of had the shoving match after they did their stare down, and my heart rate literally elevated just because of the energy that he brought into the room. It is palpable.
No, it really is, and it was like an out-of-body experience for Jacobs, because it really was impressive. Even he brought that to the fighter meetings too.
Yeah, he really did. So we're really anticipating what's going to happen with the AJ fighter meetings versus Andy Ruiz Jr., both very likable guys. And we are now waiting to speak with Anthony Joshua. Zach and Barak are getting set inside the ring. Anthony Joshua just finished up his fighter workout right here in Lower Manhattan as we are kicking off fight week right here on DAZN. The heavyweight tilt between Anthony Joshua, aka AJ, making his American debut right here at Madison Square Garden, which is right down the road. Let's check in with Ak and Barak, who's standing by with Anthony Joshua.
No media obligations done yet, except for Thursday and Friday.
I seen your face. I was like, he don't want me bothering.
All right, so AJ, you got a Miami tan, man. I see you doing yoga by the pool. You sure you was training in Miami?
It didn't look it. It didn't look it, but I stayed out of the clubs. I stayed out of the other clubs. I went down South Beach one afternoon for some lunch, which was nice.
Right.
Other than that, it was straight gut, gym work. Yeah, man.
Listen, Miami's not the place you go when you're trying to stay focused.
I heard. That was word on the streets. But the way the team set up my training is that I only had one day off in between. I never had like two back-to-back days off.
Okay.
When you have two back-to-back days, you have one for turning up and one for recovery. So all my recovery was just based around one day. So I had no time to kind of mess around or put a foot wrong.
You know, we were talking about like when after the Miller fight got canceled, people were a little down, but people have forgotten about that. They've moved on.
Yeah.
This is a real fight in front of you. This is a guy that some people say might even be harder than Miller. Yeah. How do you feel about that?
I couldn't say because I've never boxed Miller.
Right.
Them two have boxed, right? Miller and Ruiz.
Right.
But Miller was a steady contest because of his punch rate and his physical size. You can't deny that in the ring. But I think that Ruiz is more of a sound, well-balanced, feet underneath him, and little head movement. You throw the right hand, he just duck it, come under it, and then hook you twice. So he's got that type of confidence in his ability that he can kind of counter-punch, and he's not afraid to a shot to come an inch within his face and slip it and then counter-punch. He's not a scared fighter at all.
Listen, we know what you're used to in the UK,
but
how do you like this welcome in here in the US?
I should be out there with the people. That's what I'm saying. This is what I'm here to do. Like, it's kind of like to meet people. And it's all for the love of boxing.
Right.
It's not about me. It's about the next show, the Triple G show.
Right.
Whatever's happening on DAZN right now, it's just about kind of connecting with the people. So they go back and say, oh, you heard about that DAZN, boxing, da-da-da-da-da. And then the sport rises. So it's
good. It's about you right now.
This is bigger than me.
No doubt. But listen, over 100 years, heavyweight champs been fighting. I think outside of Sonny Liston and Jack Johnson, every other notable heavyweight has fought in that building.
Yeah.
You're about to make your statement and stamp your name in the game. Are you no distractions right now?
No
pressure of being in the Garden, being in New York, in the U.S. for the first time?
You know what? There is a lot. When you mention it, you kind of absorb it in.
Yeah.
But that's why I just try and come with it like I'm rolling with the punches. I'm not kind of getting lost or caught up in the hype of everything. The main time you enjoy is after the fight. God willing, I win. You know what I mean? That's when I kind of look and I say, wow, I really done it in Madison Square Garden. But I don't want to just take part. I want to own the night. And that's the win. That's why I need the win.
Listen, you got a lot at stake, not just the title.
Everything.
You got management going too, so you got guys under you as well.
Yeah, management, guys that I work with as well. everything, that's the pressure, is like boxing is just like reeled off into one aspect to another aspect. So, you know, my winning is their winning.
Right.
Because no, it's easier for them to do a job.
Not only that, like, you bring in so many UK fighters. I mean, the reason why all these other guys from the UK are fighting in the Garden is really because of you. You bring in that crowd. So a lot of guys need to thank you. You know, they're getting a check and an opportunity to fight at the Garden.
Well, that ain't going to happen. They're never going to say it. But it's all love. Do you know what I mean? Right. The opportunity. I remember I was fighting on people's undercards as well.
Yes.
And if I never said it, I want to thank you guys for kind of giving me the exposure I need to be in this position now.
Nice. So, wow. I got to ask you, man. Wow. What song are you walking out to, man? Is it going to be hip-hop? Is it going to be a dramatic song?
There's a few. Like, I was looking at Dipset Anthem. Jewel set center. Oh, it was it?
So you know Dipset. See, this guy's a real student of the game, man. You're a real hip-hop man.
To that, Meek Mill, Dreams and Nightmares. I don't know. We're mixing it a bit.
Definitely going to be somebody from the East Coast.
It has to be someone from this side, right? It has
absolutely.
To be someone from this side. So, or Biggie, you know what I mean?
Oh, man.
Yeah, so there's good opportunities. There's really good opportunities.
I mean, that's important, that, you know, because that's that when you're in that zone, walking into that ring, that song has to inspire you. It has to do something
to the crowd as well.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, because that energy, right? I remember in the Olympics, I'd been fighting 2.5 years, then I was in the Olympics. So I was like, what the fuck am I doing here? Hey. Sorry, what the hell am I doing here?
Yeah.
So I was worried. And I remember trying to block out the energy of the crowd.
But can
I really
you?
Like, no, it's impossible. You use too much energy trying to do that.
Wow.
So I just absorb all that energy. So when the crowd's buzzing and you're walking out and you're just taking in all that frequency and
you
use it in the ring, you're unstoppable, man.
So might as well, if you can't block it out, you might as well be the one to amp them up.
Absorb it. Yeah, amp them up. Let them know this is your chance to entertain, because it's too much energy and too many eyes on you to block out anything. You just got to take it all in.
Any pressure on Wilder's first round knockout and you having to perform?
It was good. It was a good one. I'm being there first round trying to knock out Rui. But, you know, if it don't happen, it don't happen. As long as I get the win, then it kind of puts me on that path. And I've said before, I think me and Wilder need to sit down man to man and talk about how we can get this fight made.
You know, we get these predictions out of him, but I think I want to wait till the win. Maybe when we talk to him after the win, we'll wait. Still too early. See how your week goes and all that.
Yeah, yeah. I need to watch back his public workout as well. Just, you know what I mean? Start gathering up some more information.
Right,
yeah.
Right.
Listen to his interviews and all that stuff.
Well, listen, New York is happy to have you, my bro.
Oh, always.
You know that.
Absolutely. I'm going to come in my Timbs.
We're supposed to come check you in Miami, but you know what I mean? You're having a little too much fun.
Timberland need to start making some boxing shoes.
Imagine.
That'd be crazy.
Yeah. Oh,
you
no,
need to talk to
we might have a relationship with Tim. We got some tips for you for Saturday night. Listen, folks, man, this is Star of the Hour. Don't miss him. Don't miss the press conference on Thursday and the weigh-in on Friday, and obviously on fight night.
Right.
AJ versus Reese.
And tonight, 40 days, the second episode.
Second episode. You might see us on there.
Thanks a lot, guys. That was an A-plus interview, and it's not that difficult to get a smile out of Anthony Joshua Sergio. We'll go with that one, too. Is that guy ever not smiling? How likable was he in that interview?
I think he covered all bases there. I mean, he promoted next week's fight when he hasn't even fought
himself. It's all about Triple G.
He's all about Triple G. And I mean, he really is incredible. And he gave everyone a shout out and didn't forget God. I mean, this is a man who doesn't forget anything or anyone. And he's promoting other people. He's promoting rappers. And he's already promoting the fight he wants to come out to. I suggest Biggie.
I like Biggie. That's a solid choice.
Biggie will be a good one. Victory, in my opinion. Or if he can come out to public service announcement by Jay-Z.
Okay.
Allow me to reintroduce myself.
My name is Ho. H to the K. Okay, we're still going.
That'll be good in New York.
That would play very well here with this crowd. And like Eddie Hearn was saying, 8,000 people will fly over from the UK to cheer on AJ as he makes his American debut. And with that, we say goodbye as we wrap up the fighter workouts that kick off fight week here in Lower Manhattan. We want to remind everyone to join us tonight for episode 2 of 40 Days of Joshua Ruiz. That's all on demand. Episode 3 will be on Thursday night. And on Thursday, the main event press conference. Friday, the weigh-in. Until then, we'll see you around the ring for Akin Barak, Dave Diamante, Sergio Mora, and yours truly, I'm LG Red.
Yeah.